Bumps and bruises, scratches and scrapes, some of the ingredients that a good life makes. But sorrow becomes success. And as we aim for the top, we will pause if we must, but we will never stop. Welcome to Simso Sessions. Welcome to Simso Sessions, the safe space to share your stories. Tonight our guest is a multifaceted, sorely tested, beautifully flawed, empathic woman who's discovered that her life's purpose is service. And to that end, and in the face of criticism, she has shared a lot of herself, even her scars, literally and physically, to show people, especially women, that we are not alone. We welcome in our safe space tonight, wife, mother, fitness guru, motivational speaker, and just an amazing human being, Shani McGraham Shirley. Hi there.
Hey, Sims.
Thank you for accepting the invitation to sit in the big chair.
It was my honor.
Oh, thank you so much. So you are at a stage in your life where you say things are good. Over 40 challenges. Life isn't perfect. Thick thighs.
Save lives.
Thick thighs, save lives. I love that. And you are a place now where you're content, and it took you a little while to get here, but this is a space in which you now sit. And in that space now, you started to share, and you're open, and you are a defender of those who, you know, are underserved, underprivileged, going through challenges. But this is who you've always been since you were...
Yeah.
I was going to say yay high.
Since my eye and my knee, yes.
Still yay high.
No bother with it. Okay. Right? I think a little taller than you, right?
But this is who you've always been. Where is that fire in the belly, Shani? Where does that come from?
You know, I really don't know. I think I do come from a line of strong women. Mm-hmm. That's the first thing. And the women in my family have always been the advocate for those who don't have a voice. Maybe I grew up seeing that. My aunts, my mom, my grandmother, it has always been there. Mm-hmm. And you know, I always tell people, you learn not what people tell you, but you learn from observing. So from my born, me I say my mother, stand up for what's right and defend those who can't, and my grandmother, my aunts. So I think maybe that's where it probably came mm-hmm. from, without me thinking about it. Because I've always been like that from ever I can remember.
Party socialization.
It is.
In your blood also.
Really and truly,
yeah.
It is.
You revealed to me that you have struggled with depression and anxiety your whole life. I don't know if that shocks a lot of people. It's always the people you never think would, you know. But from you know yourself also, from around your teenage years, mm-hmm. you were able to name it.
I can't tell you when it started in particular, but I know it was from I was a teenager. And depression would be crippling. The hormonal changes, of course, play a factor. So many teenagers go through just finding themselves with the hormonal shifts. So yes, that played a factor, but it was a little bit more than the hormonal changes. And for me, my hormonal shifts was a little worse because I actually have polycystic ovaries, which is a whole problem in itself. But there were days that if I didn't have a reason to get out of bed, I couldn't. And people love to say when people are going through depression, Lord, just make yourself feel better now. Put a smile on your face. Wipe your tears and stop the crying. And it's a lot more than that. If I could have flipped a switch, I would have. You know, I remember going through high school and I would just focus on something to get me through the first half of the day. And once I hit that point, I would then focus on, you can soon go home and sleep.
Jeez.
An orange soda, how stupid. That was my fixation to get me through the first half of the day. You're gonna have your orange soda, Shani. Once I've had my orange soda, as stupid as it sounded, you soon can go home and sleep.
And sleep was the desire because that's what depressed people want to do a lot.
And once you start sleeping, you pass that stage of, I'm rested, because it has nothing to do with tiredness. So I could, on a weekend, I could sleep for, I remember I slept for all past 24 hours. I only got up to use the bathroom and went back to sleep.
Stop it.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, and it followed me for a very, very long time.
Not only did it follow you through you, but a lot of why you say you were able to name what you had was that your mother was very observant and she saw the changes in her child. And now you say largely you feel settled because as parents, we live through the emotions of our children. And you have 3. 18, 17, and 13, Shani.
Girl.
Mercy. What? And you see a lot of, you were able to detect a lot of things in them that you saw in yourself. And so you were able to intervene early.
It's amazing that we give the best of ourselves to our children, but we also give the worst of ourselves to our children. And you can't pick and choose which attributes and...
Felt that, Shani.
You know, happiness and energy, and I wish I could just select the best part of me to give them. But all 3 of my kids, they all suffer from anxiety, manifesting in different ways. They all are emotional beings, which is a great quality to have, but it also is a burden to carry.
Yes,
2 of my 3 are very much like me, where they absorb the energy of others. So if you mix that with somebody who already have anxiety, somebody who's already emotional, and then you're pulling the energy of others, and what you also find, when you're somebody who you can make others feel good, you're gonna attract a lot of broken people. And I see it in 2 of my kids particularly. They attract friends who are going through difficult times, and then they themselves absorb that energy. So I watch my kids and I watch them fall apart when they're hurting because their friend is hurting. And I see it and I know what I've lived through and what I continue to live through. And it's hard.
Yeah.
That is, I think, for me, the hardest role I've ever had to play. Parenting my children, understanding I can teach a certain amount, but they have to experience certain things for themselves to figure out how to handle things, to figure out their own why, their own how. Because just because me tell you set the fire hot, you know, don't mean you don't believe set hot.
Yeah.
You still have to push you under the fire sometimes.
Yeah.
You know,
that's how sometimes you learn set really hot.
Yo.
You don't want to push your hand back in there. You were able to detect certain things early, and with yourself and the benefit it gave you, therapy has played a very big role. So let's talk a little bit more with Shani about that and all the other areas of her life when we come back. Soon come. Hi, guys. Welcome back. We're back with Shani. Talking before the break about the role that therapy played in your life and about the notion of not only parents knowing their kids and being able to tell a shift, but also normalizing therapy in their lives as well.
Very important. There's such a big taboo about therapy. If your foot hurts you, you find an orthopedic doctor to go to. You know, your heart hurts you, you find a cardiologist. If your emotions are struggling, if you see that you are not coping, why wouldn't you find some kind of doctor in that space to assist you? So in my household, they see therapy as, you're lucky you get to go to Auntie Tracy, because it's not taboo. They look at a therapist as one big diary, a journal, somebody who is your secret keeper, somebody who can help you give you the tools to figure out how to get where you want to go. Me, myself, I went to therapy once when I was younger. My mom eventually said, you know, I have to try something. But my mom, she studied psychology. So she herself was my therapist.
Gotcha.
I've always had a very, very close relationship with my mother. And she has been my rock ever since. You talk about unconditional love.
Mm-hmm.
Who accepts you with all of the tarnished, ugly. And don't get me wrong, you know, when I tell her something, she'd say, I'm disappointed in your choices. She still was real, but she made me feel loved no matter what and safe.
I love that.
So with that, I saw the benefits of it. So she was always and has been, and to this day, my therapist, my go-to person. And as a result, seeing with my kids whenever there was something that presented itself that seemed bigger than what I could handle. But keep in mind, you know, we're mothers and we think we can handle it all. There's a time where you have to go, yo, we need help. We can't manage.
This one is bigger than me.
This one is much bigger.
Yeah. We spoke about your journey with anxiety and depression, Shani. So how did you end up into pageantry? Because that's not a space where somebody who suffers from anxiety and depression.
Not at all. And it's funny because people see women who enter these pageants as overly confident and narcissistic and self-absorbed, and they think the sun rises and sets on them. And sometimes it's furthest from the truth, you know. I was never a pageant girl before going in, and I really wasn't a pageant girl even after. It was a fluke. I ended up there by a buck-ups. You know, I was in sixth form. I decided that, yo, I never really cut out to finish sixth form. I did the first year, and then I was like, this is not really working for me. And my mother said, well, you're not going to waste time. So between now and university, you better fill it, that gap year, with something. So my girlfriend said, my girl, you're pretty, you know. Why not go into? I didn't think I could. I'm 5'2". I entered as a fluke. I thought I could not win. Even the newspapers printed that, oh, Shani McGraham is pretty, but she's too short. She cannot win. So I had a lot of naysayers also. I remember even going on stage for one of the elimination rounds. And somebody very integral in the pageant looked at me, literally, my foot up on the step, you know, put up on the stage and said, by the way, your thighs are too big. I hope you know you need to lose 5 pounds before the final night. And this was to an 18-year-old girl who is about to parade in a swimsuit. When I said my eyes welled with tears, I strutted that stage, vexed like say. But you put yourself in a line of fire. When people enter these pageants, you're really basically saying to people, let me stand, you aim a gun at me and take your best shot. Let's see if you hit me. So we open ourselves to all of this criticism, and I personally feel that the age limit is too young. Mm-hmm. That's my opinion. I feel we need to be a little bit more experienced. We need to be a little bit more confident and self-assertive, because these pageants can create a lot of damage.
Yeah, you say they make or break, and more often than
they
not,
break than make.
So pageantry was a buck up. One thing that you knew all your life that you wanted to be was a mother. And you say the greatest irony of your life was that the one thing in life that you wanted the most, you had the most difficulty having.
So I stated before, I have polycystic ovaries. With that, a lot of people think, oh, if you have polycystic ovaries, you're infertile. You're actually subfertile. The difference is infertile, you don't produce any eggs. You cannot bear children. Subfertile means sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. So my body produces eggs, but I don't always ovulate. Mm. So I was trying to get pregnant. And as you said, the only thing, some people may say, boy, Shani, never very ambitious. All I wanted was to be a mother. That was the end all and be all. And my mindset was, come hell or high water, you know, may I have Pitney. However, I have to do this. You know, so I got married, and my husband knew that that's all I really wanted. I ended up becoming a teacher just because I love kids. Mm-hmm. I said, until I could have my own, let me practice on other people, Pitney.
Okay.
But when we got married and we're trying, nothing is happening. And you find a lot of women, we think of our womanhood and our femininity and our value and our worth by what society says a woman should be able to do. So at my very young age, I was only 24 at the time. I got married young, got married at 23. I felt that I'm already failing on this journey. All I ever wanted to be was a mother. I can't even do that right. So it was a very odd and hard space for me to navigate. You know, going in and getting checked, told you can, but you need assistance. So I was happy to know I could, but you want to do it
the natural way.
How you were meant.
How you were made to do it, right?
Real women could do it in this manner. That wasn't my reality, you know? So I was getting injections every morning. First I did try, all right, we take one type of tablet. Mm-hmm. We try and do it and you're doing the progressions. Mm-hmm. Tablets wasn't working. Stepped it up to something stronger. That wasn't working. I was deathly afraid of injections. When I said deathly, you know, all when I was a big 19-year-old, my mom still had to follow me to go and get injections. The irony, now I had to get injections every single morning to do what my body should have been doing naturally. But thank you, God, my doctor, Dr. Winter, I love you. He was able to get my body ovulating, and it was funny. He said, there are three eggs there waiting. So you could end up with triplets. I'm like, bring it on.
Ready for it.
Ready.
So you were eventually able to.
I was.
Man, let's talk about the fact that the one thing you wanted the most almost killed you.
Another irony.
We'll talk about that on the other side of this break. Soon come. Shani, everybody. So, pregnancy, delivery, death's door. One time. What happened?
One time. You know, it's funny how I've lived through this, and I've told this story so many times, but you really don't stop and put yourself back into how you're feeling in the moment when some of these experiences happened. So after struggling with subfertility and not being able to get pregnant, I finally get pregnant. Feel good about myself. Confidence shut up. You see, by the time I hit around 5.5 months, reaching 6 months, I suddenly blow up like a blowfish. I started looking as though you connected a hose to me and somebody turned on that hose and forgot to turn it off.
Oh my
gosh. I just kept swelling. Each day you saw me, I was bigger than the day before. Okay, something not adding up. I felt fine though. Check in, eventually my doctor says, you know, you have preeclampsia, we need to put you on bed rest. What do you mean I forgot on bed rest? I feel fine. What is preeclampsia, you know? So I'm navigating that. Once again, all I wanted to be was a mother. I failed at doing it by myself, needed assistance because I wasn't good enough. I am now pregnant, and once again, I'm expecting to live this fabulous pregnancy. And now you're telling me I forgot on bed rest? All right. Then each day, keep in mind, I was coming from being a beauty queen, and everybody said, oh, Shani, you're so beautiful, you're so... Well, I did get licked with ugly pregnancy stick. When I say, I can't even explain how ugly I actually got. And you're going to say, no, Shani, you only felt... No. People actually said, have you seen Shani? She's horrid. No, I actually heard this. I heard these conversations, but I'm not lying, looking back on it, they may have been right, but it still was hard to hear.
Yeah.
The hormonal changes made warts spread all over my face, my nose spread so, my neck get black, the hyperpigmentation. I mean, I morphed. So I'm on bed rest, I'm swelling by the day, I'm looking in the mirror, and I feel so unattractive. When I say so unattractive, and every day my husband would walk in and go, God, you're beautiful.
Oh, David.
David did blind. You know when I say love is blind? He did blind them time.
Take this blindness.
But I then...
Take me down to the pregnancy day, though, because clock is running and I need to get everything in, man. Tell us.
So I am not doing well. Put on bed rest. It's not working. I go and get my checks. The doctor says you need to go straight into hospital. They tried to keep me pregnant in hospital.
Oh my God.
I went to Natal first, but they realized I was considered too high risk. So they then sent me up to UA. Now this is 2 months before I'm due. I'm on bed rest and just not doing well. David calls me 5 o'clock one morning. To this day, he says his brother is who saved my life. Because he said to his brother, Stephen, Shani don't sound right. And Stephen says, call Dr. Winton, he's take this baby now.
Wow.
When they did, now whenever you have preeclampsia, delivery is what saves the mother's life. Normally everything starts to regulate once the baby comes out. It's almost as though your body's allergic to this baby inside of you, for lack of a better explanation. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. When they took India out, I started getting worse. Every organ started failing. So the hospital had it. I think we need to say our goodbyes because I was declining. I felt fine. They took her the Monday. I felt fine the Monday, Tuesday. Wednesday is when I actually thought I was going to die because I started retaining so much fluid around my lungs, I couldn't breathe. When something literally takes your breath away, that is when... So leading up to that, my mom would come to visit. I remember there was a matron in the hospital who turned my mother away from seeing me and said, she can't see you in that state. You need to go home and collect yourself and come back. She needs to pull her strength from you. It was hard for my family to see me like that, you know. And on that Wednesday, that was the only day I thought I was going to die. And I thought, my God, I'm going to die and I haven't even seen my daughter. Mm. So it was hard. It was hard. It was hard coming to the reality of, once again, I'm a failure.
You hadn't seen your baby girl up until two?
She was born two months premature, healthy as ever, but she could not leave the neonatal unit. I am high risk, considered to be dying. So David had to go and see her every day. He had to go and feed her with a syringe because she was 4 pounds.
Shani. So, okay. Ooh. You pull out of that though, Shani. And after that, you decide you're going to do it two more times. No, you went through that and you decided, and you said to me, Simone, I want a kid so bad that I decided if it killed me.
I was going to have kids. You see, when you feel that you have a certain purpose in life, and that is what you're meant to do, it's a hard feeling of not being fulfilled in what you think your purpose is. That is what gave me happiness. You know, creating my little bundles of joy. You know what I mean? That is what I felt I had to. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I had to. And I have no regrets. Mm-hmm. I have absolutely no regrets.
So the three of them now, fully grown?
Fully grown. I have made such amazing human beings. You know, I tell people, you have to love your children. Mm-hmm. You don't have to like them.
True. Not all the time.
You can love your children, but they go through phases where sometimes you don't like them. Yeah. I can honestly say I like my children.
You love them.
They're amazing little human beings.
Yeah. But each time you went through pregnancy, it took a toll on your body. And you, at 5'2", hit 200 pounds?
I busted 200.
You busted 200 pounds?
Yeah, with one of the pregnancies, I was over 200 pounds.
And that, even when you never knew it, was what was taking you into what is now a part of your core purpose, which is changing lives through exercise, through motivation, because you started doing a Zumba class, mm-hmm. right? To try and help
My own weight loss.
You're shedding off your weight. And then that Zumba teacher was leaving and the class said, Shani, we can only continue this class if you teach it.
Yeah, I was a school teacher. I was in a classroom for 10 years. Fitness was never on my radar. I ballooned so many times, changed size so many times. And at that point in my life, I was heavy. I was overweight by 40 pounds. Okay, I was a little oompa loompa, right? Getting my own exercise in the Zumba class. So when they all turned to me and said, if you teach at Shani, we're going to come. We want a class to continue. We don't care that you're heavy. We don't care that you're fat. We don't care. We enjoy doing the class.
Yeah.
And it was at that point I said, let me try a thing.
Yeah. One more buck ups, which has led her to an amazing business and an impact that she's having with women and people in general. And we'll talk more with her about that when we come back from this break. Back with Shani and how she stumbled into exercise, which is now her life. You say it's funny thing is that you don't even really like exercise. You just feel tired when you do it, but it's afterwards that you realize the joy of it and you feel good. about it. But most importantly, since you started the exercise, your depression...
My depression is handled a lot better now. It didn't eradicate it, but it made a huge difference. I'm beyond just functional. So I still have snippets where I get breakthrough. That's life, you know. Depression is something that you live with. But there are certain things that we can do to alter how our bodies internalize, interpret, handle, and exercise is what keeps me sane. Yeah. It keeps me leveled. And people love to ask me, so do you feel euphoric in the middle of exercising? Like, ah, I feel amazing. No, I feel popped down, tired, everything I hurt. But when I go without exercise, I realize how often I slip back into the lowness of depression.
Sharing these aspects and more of your journey, Shani, you've tackled everything, the depression, relationships, perimenopause, right? And what a lot of women don't know their feeling and what it actually is. And you say throughout this journey of sharing, you've lost a few people. And there are people who've come to you and say, why are you sharing so much of this about yourself? Or why don't you use your platform to go and tell women not to alter their bodies? Or so how do you balance all of that in the middle of what you're doing? Because you say you feel this, what you're doing is service.
I feel we would be in a better position if most of us would share. None of us are going through something completely alone. If there are 100 women on this planet, you best believe 100 women have been through something. If it's 10,000, if it's 1,000,000, we all have been through something. Now, if I can share my experiences with you to say, this is what I have done, you can either try what I did to get through this, or I can go, you know what? My friend Mary did have the same problem, you know. Let me see. And by sharing our stories, we can help each other. But instead, I find that many women, we're like crabs in a barrel. We feel that we need to pull down somebody else trying to get to the top, not realizing there's enough room for all of us to shine. And we would have a happier nation, a healthier nation, if we supported each other and really had community. I share with you, as a fitness instructor, people think that, you know, I'm always preaching, and it's all about your lifestyle and what you eat and the exercise that you do. And so a client came to me and said, you know, Shani, boy, I think you need to use your platform and tell people, you know, they can do everything and get back the body they had before having children with exercise and eating right. And you see what happened to that, you know, person, the social media star, you know, she did a mommy makeover and she died, you know, leaving 3 beautiful children. How could she do something that was so selfish? You need to use your platform and tell people they don't have to do that. And I looked at her and I said, you evidently missed the class where I shared I had my mommy makeover. Why? What pregnancy does to some women's bodies, it ravages some of us. Think about it. I'm 5'2". I went from 200 pounds and I went down to 126 pounds. I'm not that weight right now. But at that point, I was magasso. I was stretched out with stretch marks from here to my knees. I had 3 C-sections. I had an apron, a flap of skin that hung over my C-section scar. Can I get that body back?
Through exercise.
Through exercise and eating right. I had a drawdown magasso. I had diastasis recti where my abdominal muscles opened by 3 inches. Can I fix that on my own? No. After losing 80 pounds in total from being pregnant to what I went down. You talk about empty slippers. You ever hear that yes, terminology?
Yeah. Yes, your boobers.
Empty slippers on your chest. Yeah. Can I fix that and get back the body that I had? Now, my husband has made me feel as the most beautiful woman at every size of my journey. But the day he realized that when he would hug me and touch me in our intimate moments, and I would wince, if we're lying in bed at night and he spooned me and his hand went on my tummy, I would roll. Keep in mind, you know, I did maga down, I did draw down. But that flap of skin, as I would roll and she would roll, I felt so insecure, so unattractive. So when I made the decision to go, I'm so unhappy being like this, and I made the decision to go and fix my diastasis recti, to cut off the extra flap off of my belly, you know what I mean? To fix my breasts because I felt less than. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm not defined by it, but tell that to my emotions and how I was feeling.
Right, confidence.
Tell that to my husband that I wouldn't keep the lights on at night.
Jeez.
But my mom, staunch Christian, I tell everybody, she hold the four corners of church. Mm-hmm. I didn't know how she would handle this concept, this decision that I was making for myself. And when I said to her, I'm gonna do this, and the night before my surgery, and I am weeping, because I now felt so selfish, that am I gonna really risk losing my life? And my mom prayed with me. I pray before I do anything.
Yes.
And my mom never made me feel guilty, you know, as a staunch Christian that people, she said, God didn't give you that body, and God gave you an opportunity to reclaim and feel good about yourself. Trust in him.
Bless her. And all the others who've been there for you. Cue produce.
This is a special message from Auntie Shani. I am so proud of you. You have been such an inspiration to me. Just the way you walk with confidence, you do everything with purpose, what you have built for yourself and your business. And it's just so inspiring to see you do everything and accomplish all your goals. You are a tough cookie, I have to say, but that's just what makes us love you so much more. I can't wait to see where you go, and I love you so much.
You have embraced your role as mentor, as confidant, and as inspirer. I don't even know if that's a word, but continue doing it. Continue being a ray of sunshine to persons in your small daily messages to people on your IG page. Something as simple as that is really important to people. Continue being a powerhouse. Continue being a good wife, mother, and friend. And you are really a great, funny, like I said, small packaged powerhouse. No crying on TV.
Shani, my sister, proud of you. Big up yourself. You think large, my G.
I just wanted to say how much I love and appreciate you, from our slumber parties, to our WhatsApp messages, to our workouts where we both try to see who will break first. I love, love, love you, and how you always make time for me, even when I'm far, far away in Miami. And I could not ask for a better auntie. And I cannot wait to see you. Thank you for everything you do and for the woman that you are. And thank you for inspiring me and so many women everywhere. I love you. Bye.
I just want to let you know that you are a very, very, very special person, and you are very loved. I hope you do good today, and we just want to let you know that you're the best.
I love you, Auntie Shani. You're the best. I love to be
in TV,
and I'm excited to be with you.
Enough love. I just went through one of the hardest experiences of my life, and you are one of those people that you were there. You're the person that show up for people that you love, and I love you so much. I am so grateful that you're in my life, and I am proud to walk beside you and call you my boo. Don't tell David I said that, but you get what I mean. You know what I mean. Like, I love you, girl. Like, I am so proud of you. I am excited for your future. You deserve nothing but good things, and even more good things are on their way to you.
I just want to say I'm so proud of all you've accomplished, and boy, have you accomplished. I love the fact that you've stayed true to who you've always been, authentically, unapologetically Shani Mack. Love that about you. And in all of this, I love the fact that you still make time for everybody. I don't know how you do it, but keep it up. And the fact that you're doing all of this, please remember, I told you that Jesus was going to use that mouth for his glory. Keep it up, keep him first, and I love you to pieces.
Despite me constantly teasing you that you act older than I do, I'm sure that is the exact characteristics which has helped you become the beautiful, successful, driven, influential, and just fabulously generous person you are. I'm super proud of you on both personal and professional levels. Regardless of what is going on in your hectic life, you have never lost you, the genuinely caring person you are with your big heart. Continue to be you throughout life, and I know you will continue to go places. Love ya.
In life, everyone has that one person. The one that will tell you when you are wrong, but more importantly, will acknowledge when you are right. The person who understands you for who you are, even when you are not your best self. The person who is your secret keeper, biggest supporter and motivator, your workout partner, your house mover, wall driller, picture hanger, furniture picker, your force herself into the delivery room person, you name it, she's it. She's my person. Thank you, Shani, for being my person.
Hi, my sister. I'd just like to say a great big thank you. You have been an amazing sister, more than anyone could have ever asked. You have been the friend, you have been the support system, you have been a counselor, you have been a doctor, you have been the cook. I don't know where our family would be without you.
This is a message for the woman that I'm proud to call my mother. I'm so grateful for everything that you've done, not only for me, but for the entire family. You're such a strong and independent woman and a great role model to all of us. I'm so proud of everything that you've done to get yourself to where you are today, and I hope you continue working hard on it. And I know you're gonna do great things.
Yeah, I just wanted to say thank you for everything you've done for me. You're such a special and amazing mom. There's so many things I love about you, but I'm just gonna tell you three. First, you're compassionate, you're caring, and most of all, you're selfless. You put everyone else ahead of you, and that's such an amazing characteristic to have. And I really want to live up to you one day. I just love you so much, and I know you're gonna do so many amazing things. Love you, bye.
Hey, and I just want you to know how much I appreciate you, and I think you're an amazing person. I'm so glad that you're my mom, and I think everything you do is just an amazing, and I want to be like you when I grow up. I think you are just capable and just able to do anything you put your mind to, and I think that's an amazing mindset to have. I think that you are an amazing human being, and I strive to be more like you. I love you, Mom.
Just want to say how much Dad and I love you, how much we treasure you, how much we care about you in every way, because you are such a special woman. You have been a special daughter to us. You have been a caregiver from you were very young, taking care of all of us. Nothing was too hard for you to take on. You have a beautiful soul. You extend yourself not just to your immediate family, but to your extended family, to your clients, to your friends, to everyone who comes across your path. You give and give until it hurts. And so today, I just want to say how much we admire you, all you have done, all you have accomplished, how much we treasure you for this special person that you are. And we trust that you will continue to be the woman that you have grown to be. Love you very much.
Hey, Shani, just wanted to say congratulations on all your success. We continue to support you. We think you're amazing. We're truly blessed to have you in our life. And thank you for all that you've done for our family. You know, India, Ty, Mali, and myself really look to you as a strength in this family. And you continue to help others and, you know, just be you. So from all of us, we just want to say, wish you continued success. Love you.
Lord Jesus. I wasn't ready. I'm such an ugly crier. Oh, God. I hope you just edit.
No, never, ever, ever. You're crazy, girl. We can't. 20 years of marriage with that man who has been with you through your highs, your lows, your ups, your downs. Your family is beautiful. Your kiddos are beautiful. Just soak it in, girl. Soak it in. We're going to give you some time to soak it in. See makeup in here? We're going to fix you up.
Yeah, try come sort this out, cause
we'll soon come. I'm sorry. I'm not sorry. All right, we're back with our final segment with Shani, who you say now you're sitting squarely in your purpose. You're at a good, content place, and you realize your life is about service, especially to other women. And a lot of that has to do with your authenticity. And you say you realize you're not perfect, and your mouth is loud, and you, but this is not the way you planned it. And generally, you're not a planner, but your life is evidence of surrender. Talk to me a little bit about that.
That's a very powerful word, surrender. The day you stop fighting and forcing doors to open for you and forcing opportunities to come your way and fighting for your voice to be heard, the day you surrender is when all that is meant for you will come to you. I've had to learn that very young, that God walks with me. I am a praying woman. I listen. I learned a harsh lesson that when you don't listen to God's words and his direction, he will make it so that you can't ignore him. And I learned that lesson loud and clear. And from that day forth, I've learned to surrender and trust in him. Sometimes when David goes, so where are you going to get the money for do that? I go, I don't know, but God won't give me. How is that going to happen? I don't know, but I'm trusting in it. And the most beautiful thing for me is finding my purpose, walking in my purpose, and seeing what blossoms from that journey. I'm a service provider. I love helping people. And people think it's a very selfless act. It's actually a selfish act. Why? Yes, I'm helping women, I'm helping others in different areas, but it feeds my soul. It makes me feel good knowing that I have helped somebody. Like a few weeks ago, maybe 2 months ago, somebody called me in tears on the phone. And she asked, where was I? And her car found my house. And knowing that she was on her way to me, I prayed and I said, God, put the words in my mouth that I need to deliver to her. And so said, so done. At the end of my talk with her, she goes, Shani, you're the only person who has ever said this to me. How would you know to say that? And I said, I prayed before you came here.
Mm-hmm. And people don't often think you're a praying person.
No, because I load.
Yeah.
My mouth is like a sailor.
Yeah.
You know, they're like, you know, she's scantily dressed. It's not very, God knows my heart. Don't try and think you know who a Christian woman is, a praying woman. There are many people inside church holding up four corners of church and inside very dirty. Don't judge. I try and live my life as best as I can and in a way that I know God would be proud of me.
I'm proud of your deeds, you said.
There you go.
Proud of your deeds. Yeah.
Do I make mistakes? All the time. And I ask for my forgiveness, and I try to do better.
Could your faith be stronger?
Of course.
Yes.
Could I go to church every Sunday? I should be. I give you a joke. Many nights I fall asleep without saying my prayers. Every night, my husband drops to his knees and says his prayers at the bedside. I said, Shani, you need to do better. But you drop asleep sometimes. Every time I see on my phone a double digit, it's 11:11, it's 10:10, it's 12:12. Once I see a double digit on my phone as a time, I say a prayer anytime I see that. And that has actually helped me to go, God never say I have a prayer at nighttime. God never say you have to come in fellowship at this particular wherever I am.
Talk to him.
I talk to him, and my prompt is when I see double digits on my phone.
Well, we thank you for listening to all your prompts that he's given you, because you are making and have made a difference in the lives of many women. And we'll continue to. I tell you, it's the psychology in the future, but that's something for another time. But you have to learn how to protect yourself even in the service that you give. Right?
Very important.
We spoke about that. Thank you, Shani,
for being here
today, for sharing so much of yourself with us. We know this program will touch somebody somewhere, and you'll get the feedback in your socials, as will we.
Oh, trust me.
Yes, yes.
Good and bad. And in between.
She's good for the world. It's not a problem. But bless you and thank you for being here.
Thank you.
On Sim Soul Sessions. Time for an affirmation, everybody, to close the show. Okay, so many things in life are hard to carry, but none as heavy as the weight of perfection. The load that is pretense, the heaviness of all is well. And if that's the case with you, then you are indeed blessed. But if it is not, please know that you are most of us who have days we don't know. And we know we don't know. But we're not afraid to acknowledge that we don't know and that it's okay to not know, but also okay to find out, to seek the answers we need, to gain the knowledge and the tools to help ourselves, to find out what we don't know, why we feel this way all the time, every day, and how to give ourselves a fighting chance to fix it. Because indeed, everybody, life is beautiful when you know you are not alone, that others are going through what you are, feeling the same way you do, who have passed the worst and can help you do that too. But first, you have to share that you need help so they can share their wise counsel with you. Tonight we are affirming, I will not allow pride to imprison me. I will free myself by seeking the help I need to make the change I need. And that is our soul food and our show for this evening. Thank you for watching, everybody. We are back next week with another story of the power of the human spirit. Until then, every blessing, and please remember to count your blessings.